Hello, Cruel World. We have a very special guest on today, Sarah Ferris. Hello to you, Sarah.
Hello, how are you?
Very well, thank you. So Sarah and I are buddies from CrimeCon, where we both attended last September, was it?
Yeah, well, it feels like ages ago now.
So can I tell you what I think the bits that kind of really stand out to me in this case? I knew the broad bits and pieces, but I didn't know any kind of level of this detail, so thank you for explaining that. That's because I wanted to give you authentic answers and not because I was too lazy to do any research.
You tell yourself that.
Telling my viewers that. I never lie, you know that. The first thing that really strikes me compared to other fraud that I've either sort of read about or dealt with myself personally is just the level of patience. So he really like was extremely cunning and conniving, right? He waited 40 years. Like most people, regardless of whether they're con artists or not, would not have the delayed gratification to wait that long. They want their riches much, much sooner. Even you know, delaying it for a couple of years is quite a big cognitive load to take on, all this guilt for such a long period of time, but he could do it for decades. So that is extremely unusual. And I suppose the other thing, which is just the absolute lack of empathy. So most con artists will have some degree of distance from their victim. And even like victims who were in a romantic relationship with somebody they ripped off, I mean, that's still pretty heartless, but that's different from knowing a family for decades and to sit there in a dying room and to have a child with fragile X that you're spending time with, knowing that you're basically screwing over their future. I mean, that's just like a next level lack of compassion and empathy. And I suppose the other thing is that surprises me is I wonder what his exit plan was. Because surely it must have been quite hard to get away with it, right? Like without him having to uproot his entire life, because he's literally living with and growing up with, and his family is growing up with his victims in a small community.
That's right. And it is a small community. So it's a town of like 150,000 people. And you think 81 victims, what are the ripple effects out from that? The number's huge. And that's the only ones that came forward. I'm sure people didn't come forward because there's so much shame around being conned, isn't there, really? Yeah. His exit plan, good question. So in court, that obviously was asked to him, and also in restorative justice. So he did 15 sessions of restorative justice, and across that time, so many of the victims obviously asked, what was your end game? And he was going to start paying back the oldest first, and then the sick. So he had an actual scaled system that he said he was going to do. And even in those restorative justice meetings, he said he still planned on paying it back. In your experience of con artists, when they say something along those lines, is that coming from delusion, or is it just that they are so pathologically lying?
I think it depends on the individual's case, so you have to kind of examine the entire behavior. So somebody who is pathologically lying, even though they might describe like some sort of exit plan, they won't have put into place any actual methods of carrying it out. Somebody who's delusional usually, well, actually both of them will lack empathy or lack remorse, but somebody who is delusional just won't be able to kind of logically explain what their situation is. Does that make sense? They're two slightly different cognitive processes. Like majority of people that commit fraud, especially sophisticated fraud like this, are not mentally ill. So most of them are doing it out of greed. It's only a very small proportion who would have a sort of mental illness, because mental illnesses, generally, they're quite blunt tools. So if somebody's like, you know, delusional, hearing voices, psychotic, then usually their functioning decreases as well. So it's usually relatively obvious to pick up, and they struggle with complicated cognitive tasks. So if you think about the person I was talking about specifically in my book, I was really skeptical for many reasons. And one of those reasons was that she was claiming that she was really depressed and mentally unwell, but her level of functioning was actually very sophisticated.
The other thing that you bring up in your book, which I thought was absolutely fascinating, was that distinction of mad or bad. Where does that line get drawn? How do you make that distinction?
So that is a good question. It's a complicated question because it kind of depends on the context. So if you're talking about like a medico-legal context, or somebody that's done something in the criminal court, there's, when you look at mad, there's different ways of defining it. If you define it as somebody that just does something that's completely incomprehensible to you, like kills a family member or, you know, sexually assaults a child, then you could say that almost anybody that does that is mad because you can't understand how you do that. So that would be the layman's kind of interpretation. The psychiatrist's interpretation would be about a specific diagnosis. So if somebody's got something like a delusional disorder or schizophrenia, and you can prove that they've got a very fixed delusional belief. So hypothetically speaking, if somebody believed that they were a multimillionaire, so that's a relatively common grandiose delusions, but somehow are still able to have the cognitive sort of ability to commit fraud. And it's possible, it's unlikely, but it's possible. And if you could prove that, you can't just take their comments at face value. You have to, you know, look through the medical notes, see that this was a consistent thing that they've reported throughout previous hospital admissions. That would be the way of defining it from a psychiatrist's point of view. But perhaps the most important definition would be a legal perspective. So that's when we're talking about the insanity defense. So your listeners have probably heard of not guilty by reason of insanity. And that threshold is very high. So it's only actually found in a very small proportion of cases. So even if you're unwell, even if you're psychotic, that doesn't mean that you necessarily reach the threshold. And to reach that threshold, you either didn't know what you were doing or you didn't know that it was wrong. So again, right. to use the sort of the hypothetical situation, either you literally, and again, it's on the defense to prove this, you literally thought that you had so much money that you could replace it easily. So you didn't think that you were ripping people off money. Or that you had nihilistic delusions and you didn't believe that the very concept of money exists, so therefore you couldn't be ripping somebody off. But obviously you'd have to be pretty unwell to have those kind of thought processes. So those are the kind of people that would be in and out of hospital, psychiatric hospital, and would be extremely unwell. They're not kind of sophisticated fraudsters that you tend to see.
So in your experience, you wouldn't expect to find a con artist fraudster sitting in that mad column.
Yeah, exactly right. I think I've seen it once in my career. And I think it was a very low level fraud. It's identity fraud. I think she'd use like some fake identity to get a passport illegally. And completely separate to that, she actually had schizophrenia, but she committed her offences, I think, with the aids of other shady people in the criminal underworld who she was related to. But she became psychotic. And when I saw her, she was just so unwell. She was like screaming, shouting. She'd not eaten for days. She had her children taken away from her. She had like feces spread across her own house. So I'm not suggesting that everybody who's mentally ill is like that. But what I'm saying is, for somebody to be so unwell that they couldn't even plead or they would have an insanity defense, we're talking about people who are extremely unwell, not people who are functioning.
Yeah, I mean, in that case, it sounds more like that the fraud was just a byproduct of all the rest of the stuff going on.
The fraud was a coincidence to her mental illness. But from every other case that I've seen of fraud from my professional career, I've never seen a case. I've seen some people trying to convince the court that they were unwell, like the woman I've talked about in my book, but I've never actually seen a credible case.
They're obviously in the bad column. Is there a broad kind of, you know, paint with a broad brush, but particular traits or behaviors that you would expect to see in somebody who commits fraud?
Yeah, absolutely. So the most obvious one, you don't have to be a psychiatrist to call this one out, is greed. So people who are career fraudsters don't just have an ordinary level of greed of wanting, you know, nice things to project a certain image. They go beyond that, where they're almost never satisfied with whatever kind of financial gain they get. And I think in terms of their actual behaviors, I think it's all about grooming. And what surprises me about Barry Clue is how effective he was at grooming. So grooming is, as you'll know, is where you know, if you come up to somebody, especially somebody you don't know, even somebody you do know, and you say, I've got this scheme that's going to give you a great return and you're going to get thousands of pounds, then unless somebody's very gullible, no one's going to believe you. So the way that people work is they gain small bits of confidence over increments over a long period of time. Usually months. It's very unusual for it to be decades like this man. But it's like the slowly boiling frog. You know, the frog doesn't know he's being boiled because the temperature's rising so gradually they don't even notice. So I think that's what happens. So have you seen The Tinder Swindler?
Of course I have. Yeah. Of course I have.
That's an absolutely perfect example of somebody who's really adapt at grooming. So I'm sure this guy Barry was as well. But The Tinder Swindler, he created this image before he got into any money troubles that was so bulletproof because he'd exposed these women to his lifestyle several times. So over time, they had no reason to doubt him. What I'm saying is, to be a good, effective fraudster, to get the average mark, you have to actually be very charming and you have to be able to groom people.
And I think that's a misconception, isn't it? That you can't be conned. And it is that missing piece of the puzzle, the grooming, isn't it? That's the recipe. Almost.
And also, absolutely, no, I completely agree with you. I think the other thing is that, I mean, we're talking about, you know, financial fraud. I think most people have some sort of weakness or something that they're very passionate about. So if you're crafty enough to find out what that thing is, and you can find somebody that'll be willing to almost freeze reality to believe what they want to believe, right? Money's the most obvious one, but if somebody wants fame, I think that would be another good example. Everything from, you know, casting agents to PR companies. I've even fallen short of this myself, actually. Years ago, when I was trying to break into the world of media, I've had PR companies that promised me the world. And you believe them because, first of all, why wouldn't you? And secondly, because this is exactly what you want to hear and what you've been looking for months. So when the opportunity finally shows itself, then you're primed to be conned, I think. And it's different things for different people, I think.
Well, I think the irony is, I don't know if you read this article on the Tinder swindler, but he actually ended up being conned recently himself because he wanted fame, and he paid someone so that he would get the blue tick on Twitter, and it was a complete con. He parted like $10,000. That's the best karma.
The other thing is narcissism is, and that's not quite the same as greed, but I think a lot of the people, and possibly this Barry Clue, they project this image. I think we all project images of ourselves, but there's something about them where they feel that they need to keep up this image that they've kind of cultivated. So I guess what I'm saying is, more than the average person, they need to be the cool guy with the cool car that, you know, looks, that has this kind of lifestyle. I think a lot of people, you know, fantasize about those kind of things, but we have these ethical boundaries. You know, the average person wouldn't kill or steal to get those things or con. Whereas I think con artists have a deep sense of narcissism, and all narcissism comes from insecurity, which suggests that possibly at some point something happened to make them feel insecure, whether that was, you know, parents who didn't give them love or support, or whether it's them being bullied or sidelined at work, or, you know, they enter a job where they feel that their tasks or their role is inferior to their intelligence or education. It's different for different people, but usually there's something that causes an inferiority complex, and that causes narcissism.
And can you give a little description of what narcissism actually is in its day-to-day form?
Sure. Narcissism, it's about being the center of attention and only wanting other people to love you. So narcissistic people, including people with narcissistic personality disorder, which is actually a psychiatric diagnosis, they only care about themselves. So they're the kind of people that I'm sure we've all met people like this, who will constantly talk about themselves, never ask you a question about yourself, sort of indifferent to other people, even people that they're potentially in relationships with, or even family members. They love praise. They kind of set up situations where they're the center of attention. They constantly question, either directly or indirectly, their worth to other people. So if there's any situation, the kind of questions they would ask or the kind of conversations they would start would be, how did I look or how did I come across in that, rather than, you know, how are the other people feeling? And they take criticism really badly. So they either completely dismiss it, as in, this person doesn't know what they're talking about, or they become abnormally upset and they focus way too much on criticism than is healthy.
That's interesting. Now, I haven't actually struck upon anyone who's criticized Barry, so I don't know about that, but obviously it all rings true. The flashy cars, the holidays, everything was about the big I am, essentially, with him. So that would, that could fit. Is there any different things that they have? Like, I've heard of things like predatory memory or like an empathy switch, something that would fit within the con artist's makeup.
Yeah, I mean, I think all con artists have a lack of empathy, but I think some people, like this guy Barry Clue, must have like an extra layer of decreased ability to feel empathy if they commit these cons to people that they actually know personally. I suppose the other thing is denial to a degree. It's quite a complicated one, because when I say denial, they know what they're doing is wrong. That's unquestionable. But I think possibly, especially in a Ponzi scheme, they might believe that they can somehow make it back miraculously, even though that doesn't make sense to us. So like a gambler would be a perfect example of this. Somebody who, despite the fact that they've lost money over and over again, they're convinced they just need to make one or a couple of good bets and they'll win it all back. So I think some con artists just don't care, and they just want to run off the money. But I think some, especially people like this guy, especially if they're in a Ponzi scheme, probably to a degree, even though deep down they know it's not going to happen, part of them lives with this hope that somehow they'll turn it around and be able to get everyone's money back.
Yeah, and I think that was articulated quite a few times through the court. He did say things like, I took a wrong turn at one stage and just didn't go back on the right path. So yeah. Whether or not it was premeditated, it's hard to know. Is there any way that you can tell whether some crimes like that are premeditated?
This is going a bit left field here. I think that these kind of crimes, so types of frauds that have been committed repeatedly over a long period of time, are neither premeditated or impulsive. I think they're somewhere in between, which is you either by creation or accident get away with a small tiny bit of fraud, and then mm-hmm. it doesn't come back to you, you don't get caught, and then you think, right. Well, that was only a little bit, that was only, you know, 10 bucks, and then you might do it again and again, and then you increase it a little bit, and then you do it again and again and again. And I think it snowballs over time. You become more confident in yourself because mm-hmm. nobody's picking you up on this. And in the case of someone like Barry Clue, the auditors are missing it. Other people that I'm working with are missing it. People seem to trust me. So I guess what I'm trying to say is I don't think it's like an evil sort of rubbing your hands decision that I'm going to rip all these people off one day. It's almost like they're grooming themselves. It's a gradual increase of, well, I got away with this. Well, that person doesn't really seem to mind. And I'm not in any way trying to decrease their responsibility, but I think they don't have the same obvious flood of guilt that you or I might expect. I think that over time they get away with it more and more and more, and they care a bit less over time about the consequences, and they excuse their own guilt over time, I think.
Like an incremental criminal. Just
exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Little steps.
This thing is, right, if you think about it, if you were in Barry's shoes and if you'd got away with it for decades, literally decades, then
yeah,
there's no reason to worry, really, is there?
Why do you think it is that we as humans are susceptible to being conned? Because it's so much about trust, isn't it?
Yeah. So I think it was a bit like what I was talking about before. I think most people have something that they believe is missing in their life. Yeah. And some people it's as simple as, you know, money. And that's understandable. People want a more comfortable life, especially if for example, you're in a job that you don't particularly enjoy and you've been doing it for months, years, and you don't feel like you're getting the return that you deserve. So basically all YouTubers, then you can understand why.
Or podcasters.
Or podcasters. You can understand why if a kind of easy option presents itself, if you've trained your mind to look for that thing, then I think not everybody, but a lot of people are primed to be conned. I think that's part of the reason. But I suppose in this specific case of Barry, you just wouldn't suspect it. You know, I wouldn't suspect it. I do actually have a financial advisor, and this conversation is scaring me. But if I had
as it should.
If I had a scheme that I had with somebody for 15 years and it seemed to be fine, then I probably would go with them to invest the money, really, because it's easier to go with somebody that you know and have no suspicions of than having to go through the whole process of finding somebody else. So I actually think it's scarily difficult to pick out somebody like this particular man.
Yeah. And there is a lot of shame that you should have spotted it. You should have reacted or seen some red flags.
Yeah.
But in your experience, how easy is that to spot?
I think there are red flags when it comes to fraud, but I think they are fallible. And I think in this case, possibly Barry has managed to somehow sidestep all of them. So again, talking about financial advisors, things like reviews. So you've got to be suspicious if you look on a really pretty, cleverly designed website, but there's not really any client reviews, or there's quotes from people that can't be kind of checked. So no reviews, no evidence of testimonials, credible testimonials from previous clients. If there's no real substance to what they're saying. So I think if they talk really vaguely about terms, as opposed to, you know, this is your portfolio and these are the figures and this is what we invest in, that's what you want to see. You want to see some detail, even though when my financial advisor talks to me, I don't understand any of it. At least sometimes he's saying something versus somebody that has these kind of, you know, vague, random statements. And I think basically a traceable history is always a sign of a good investment. And also somebody who, connected to that. If there's a lot of moving around or a lot of vagueness or uncertainty, not just in their statements, but in their actual history, then that would be another flag. And I suppose finally, if somebody's a bit too keen, you've got to wonder why. So if you've got somebody who's a financial advisor who claims to be able to give you an amazing return on your money, you've got to ask why hasn't a lot of other people signed up? And why is this person so keen to sign me up? Because surely if I'm getting, you know, 10% return within a year, then surely everybody would be up for it. So why are they so keen to get my business? Having said all of that, I don't think Barry actually used any of those tactics. So I think he's almost infallible. I don't see how anybody realistically could have known without the benefit of hindsight, really.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's where there needs to be governing bodies that are overseeing that. I mean, what is an authorized financial advisor comes into to play there. Now, one thing I didn't mention is in the judge's sentencing notes, there was a psychologist that had assessed him. And what the psychologist says is he refers to Barry having a cognitive disorder or dissonance.
Yeah.
Can you explain what that means?
Sure. So cognitive dissonance is like a psychiatric phenomenon or psychological phenomenon, I should say, where somebody has two separate thoughts that are opposing and it causes them like distress inside. So to be specific for Barry, maybe one of his thoughts was, I'm a good person, I'm part of this community and people like me. So that'd be one aspect of his image that he has. But obviously deep down, he knows that he is ripping people off. So even though he might have a degree of denial, and I think he probably did, and even though he might have tried to convince himself that he's going to get at least some of the money back, which is what he said during the restorative justice, I'm sure to a degree he must have known that he was ripping people off. So those are two kind of opposing thoughts. So that causes psychological distress and people react with it in different ways. Some people go and confess and change their ways. Some people become really bitter and twisted, or some people, you know, just displace it in some other way. So that's what cognitive dissonance is, when you have two internal things that are struggling against each other. Sexuality was a big thing, not so much nowadays, but decades ago when it was less acceptable, that would be another big kind of area of cognitive dissonance where a man or woman might think they're gay, but know it's socially unacceptable. So they try and kind of hide it or displace it. So it's just mm-hmm. it causes this internal kind of struggle.
And is that something that you would see with con artists? Is that like a normal trait, or is that just something perhaps more specific to this case?
I think most con artists are just greedy, just want to do something relatively quick, take the money and dash, and have very little remorse or empathy. Most would fit into that category. I think there would be some, especially if they're closely connected to their victim, you know, whether that's a romantic relationship or whether, like in this case, they've known them in the community. I think there probably is a degree of cognitive dissonance. But I suppose it was like what we were talking about before, over time, when you can kind of chip away at your own guilt or reduce your own guilt because it's lasted for such a long period of time. I think the same thing happens with cognitive dissonance to a degree.
Hmm. So we touched on it earlier about those emotions that con artists display. If you saw, for example, Barry Clue empathizing with a person that is dying, how, in your experience, would you believe that empathy to be actually genuine?
I think if you saw it, so if we were witnessing him at that moment next to a dying sort of friend who had esophageal cancer, I think it would come across as very real. I think that even the best psychiatrist in the world, which I'm not, would not be able to really be able to differentiate that, because it's all internal. In fact, you could even go further to say that, and again, I'm not trying to excuse any of his actions, but some people, especially people who are good at conning other people, can con themselves to a degree. So they're able to compartmentalize their guilt from their compassion. So I guess what I'm trying to say in a long-winded way is he might have had a degree of empathy at the time for his friend dying, even though deep down he knew he was going to rip his wife off. He just was able to split that more than you or I or a normal person could do. I mean, the other thing that I haven't really said about Barry is, and I'm loath to overuse this phrase because it gets overused so much, especially by psychiatrists such as myself, is psychopath. So as you probably know, for those of your listeners and my viewers who don't, a psychopath is not necessarily associated with violence. It's somebody who lacks empathy, doesn't learn from their mistakes, acts impulsively, acts aggressively, doesn't care about the rights of others, doesn't care about the law. So it's all those things, but they're also quite charming and manipulative. So I think there's a strong case that Barry might be all of those things, actually.
Yeah, that did come up in court. A few people threw that word around. Okay. What about remorse?
I mean, again, remorse, a bit like empathy, is it's quite easy to fake, isn't it? So I guess the way to really analyze that is remorse through behavior rather than through words. So if he's saying that he's really sorry and he's apologizing to all these people when they see him in prison as part of restorative justice, that doesn't mean anything because anyone can say that. But you know, if he has in any way tried to make amends I'm not sure how he would, because I imagine all his assets would be seized. But if he did in any way, then I suppose you could argue that he might have a level of remorse. But I'd be surprised if that happened, to be honest.
Yeah. I think even the judge in the case and the sentencing notes said the way that he apologized and showed remorse was actually really patronizing and almost re-victimizing of the victims. He'd say things along the lines of, you couldn't have done anything. There was nothing that you could have done.
You could argue that he can't really have remorse, can he? Because it's not something he did in a sort of impulsive flash of rage or anger. It's not like, you know, other patients that I see might get into fights when they're having an argument or get drunk and do something that they clearly regret. But this is somebody who's carried out calculated activities for decades. So I'm not sure if it's even possible that he could have any level of remorse. I mean, obviously he's sad that he got caught. I don't doubt that. But whether he actually really cares about the victims, I don't know if that's possible.
Yeah.